Hi, my name is Juan Marin, and in God's mercy, God has put Richard and I, Roxanne, a few of us together in our lives. You know, I had great changes in my life a couple of years back, and I think when I had my great changes, when he got freed, about 2 months earlier, and then 6 months later, we met. You know, God put us in the path together, and I think God did a good thing in getting us together, because I guess in my process and growth, you know, I know that a lot of people try to put God in the box. You know, when we get to, when we learn about Jesus and we get that love, sometimes we think we know and we understand God and we want to put him in the box, but there's so much to learn about God. There's so much love, there's so much everything. There's that love, you know, it just can't be contained. A lot of times we have difficulty in our sin to be able to understand how great that love really is. And it's when you, I know Richard can understand quite a bit because of the depths he's been in. I never went to jail. I never killed people. I never thieved or drugs, none of that. But God put two people together to work together as a team. You know, and together we have been working on a team. We kind of get in trouble sometimes with pastors. We've been accused of running amok, so we say we run amok for Jesus. You know, so, you know, we take it in good stride. You know, just we do things outside the box. You know, we go to high schools. We go to the high schools out there. We used to be Watts in South LA, the worst of the schools, and talk to kids. You know, last week we got invited to go to Lutheran high schools, and we're going to different high schools and I think colleges now too, and in different churches. We go to churches on Sunday. We go to churches on Saturday. We one of our most favorite churches is the Seventh-day Baptist Church. We have so much fun there. It's such such a family there. And that's where we met a lot of wonderful people. And we just keep going around because God has people everywhere. Yeah. God has people in different churches, different places, in different streets, different gutters. There are people there that God wants us to reach or to just hold or to just say God loves you, you know, or sometimes, you know, just come on board and let's praise God together sometimes. You know, we go into different churches and they say, where do you guys come from? We tell, well, we're Sabbath keepers, you know, and they say, so what are you doing here? And all we can say is, all we say is we came to praise God with you. And I guess after that, they really can't say a whole lot. They say, come on in. You know, so we go into a lot of churches, different types of churches. And sometimes Richard gets a little surprised. But we do enjoy going to meet other people of all races and all denominations and go to very questionable places sometimes. You know, we're out in the streets talking to drug addicts. We're talking to prostitutes. We go to a lot of places. And
you're where Jesus was.
Yeah, so we go meet them where they're at.
That's right.
You know, we're not trying to drag anybody into church. God, we just take the word. We take the seed, and God does the growing and the changing.
Amen.
You know, and that's the way we try to look at what we do, is to just take the word, and God will clean them.
Amen.
You know, and I know God did put us together to go out there. And it was amazing how just not too many months after I went through something, he came out of jail just 2 months prior, and then 6 months later, six, 7 months later, we meet. You know? And we've been on a journey together. You know, I got to be his best man when he got married, you know, and I'm uncle to his little son, and Roxanne, you know, they got married, and you know, we've been pretty close. It's wonderful to be running around amok for Jesus, you know, running amok for Jesus. We really do enjoy doing what we do, and for us, it's fun. We really enjoy the people, and the meeting. It's really awesome to just meet new people, and that's how we met. He came out of, he was in jail for how many, 24 years, 26, and I've heard a lot of the stories behind the scenes of a lot. There's a lot to tell. We can be here for hours, but it is wonderful how Jesus you know, brought him out of where he was at and saved him, because you know, he tells stories of he was the only one standing, you know, out of shootouts. Who knows how many shootouts? He's the only one standing. And God had kept him alive for a purpose, for his purpose, his plan. And Richard knows that he's here on earth until God tells him, you know, you're done, you know, and he'll happily rest. But he knows he's here for a purpose. And he's here for Jesus, and he's proud to work for Jesus. And that, and Richard.
Happy Sabbath. My name is Ricardo Sepulveda, and I'm a soldier of Christ. I'm a, like they said, I'm a disciple. I'm the 13th disciple. You know, because I serve an awesome God. You know, before I start my testimony, God's testimony, I would like you guys to turn to John 14:14. And that's a promise from our God that I stood upon, you know, when I met my God, which is Jesus Christ. John 14:14. And what it says, if you ask anything in my name, I will do it. You see, that's one of God's promises, that whatever we ask in his name, not my name, not my brother's name, not the pastor's name, but in God's name, he will do it. It will come too. You know, because my God's not a liar. All his promises. I mean, this is a promise from the Bible that I stood upon. You see, my story starts when I was a young boy. I come from a family of 10. I'm the youngest one. I have 5 sisters and 5 brothers. My mom was a single parent, but she was also an alcoholic. You see, at a young age, my brothers were into prison, into drugs, into gangs. My sisters were out there partying, getting pregnant by anybody and everybody that would tell them they loved them. You see, and I was the youngest one, and I was seeing all this. I was raised in that. God and love wasn't inside my house. It was all about partying, drugs, and trying to make money the fast way. That's what I was taught. That's the love I was taught. You see, and at a young age, I started looking at how can I become a millionaire by the time I turned 21. At 6, 7 years old, those were my thoughts at that young age. You know, that I wanted to become a millionaire to buy a bar and to buy all the drugs I can for my family. I was going to take care of my mom, and I was going to take care of my 9 siblings, but I needed to come up with a plan to make that happen. So at a young age, I started thinking of how could I become rich quick, selling drugs, becoming a hitman, you know, all those options. It wasn't about school no more, so it was about the drugs and supporting. At the age of 13, I started using heroin. That's what I wanted for my birthday. I shot up heroin. And I had came across some money at a young age doing crimes. I didn't know God. Nobody had ever talked to me about God. So I used to go steal from the Catholic churches. I don't know if you guys been inside a Catholic church. They got those saints with piggy bags that they dropped the money to pray. Well, I used to go and open those things and buy them, get the money, you know, offerings or whatever. In Catholic churches, I used to do that. I used to come out and buy BBs to shoot bears with that money. See, I had a BB gun. I bought a BB gun at a young age, so I was practicing how to become a shooter. So I would steal the money from Catholic churches to buy BB guns to kill birds. See, I was practicing. You see, the devil had already planted his domain in my house because God wasn't there. My mom wasn't into a religious person. She was into alcohol. You know, my brothers and sisters were in and out of prison, ODing, drugs, running from the law. So I never saw a Bible, and if I did, I didn't even know what it was. I was too young and nobody ever taught me about the Bible. At the age of 13, I started using heroin. At a young age, I started doing crimes. I started carrying a gun, 9mm, at the age of 13. I would go to school with a gun. Nobody in my school knew I was carrying guns. I was doing robberies on Fridays to support my habit and to save money to buy stuff that I needed for my family. I would supply money for my brothers to go get their drugs so they wouldn't get arrested. I would give them hundreds. The robberies I would do, I would buy heroin for me that they didn't know. But the extra money, I would give my brothers money to go buy dope for them so they wouldn't have to go do crimes because they were already of age. That if they would get arrested, they would go to prison. I was 13. Nobody knew I was pulling these robberies. And if they would catch me, I was a youth. I wouldn't do that much time. You know, all this was, I was learning while I was growing up at the age of 13. The age of 13, we went to Mexico, Juarez. I'm from El Paso. I was born in El Paso, but I was raised in the system, in the prison system. The age of 13, we crossed to Juarez, Mexico, which is right across the border from El Paso, Texas, to go to a gentleman's bar over there in Juarez. In Mexico, as long as you got money, that age don't matter. They'll sell alcohol to you anywhere in Mexico. They don't card you, not like the United States. You have to be 21, they'll card you. Mexico don't card you. As long as you got money, you don't have to be with an adult. As long as you got money to pay for your alcohol, they'll sell you alcohol. 9-year-old, 10-year-old, 8-year-old, if you got the money, they'll sell you the alcohol. We went over there to keep on the party that we started in El Paso, after our party. At that bar, it's a gentleman's club, you know, high class men, businessmen, you know, drug dealers, head drug dealers, that I didn't know about, that they were in that bar. We stopped because it was closest to the border. In case we got in trouble, we could run to the bridge and cross over and we'll be in the United States. But I didn't know that if you take a gun from the United States to Mexico, you cannot cross that gun back this way because of customs. You go through a metal detector. I didn't know about the metal detectors at that age. See, at that bar, there was this friend of ours, a girlfriend, partying with us. One of the gentlemen, I guess, told her something or looked at her the wrong way that she got offended. And I had already been doing heroin before we got to Mexico. I had the gun with me. And when that girl came from the restroom, she leaned over and told me that gentleman disrespected me and I didn't like the way he. I took it offensive. I took it like he did it to me. So there was mirrors like this, mirrors. All the bars have mirrors. So I was watching him. In my mind, I was planning, I'm gonna kill this man to show my friends how cool I am. You know, nobody knows I got a gun. So I'm gonna show them, I'm gonna show them an adventure they'll never forget. We're in Mexico, they don't prosecute in Mexico. I'm gonna show them what I'm capable of. I've been shooting birds already, so I know how to shoot. But this is a 9mm. I've never shot a 9. I saw that gentleman got up, and I got up and walked towards him. I guess he was leaving, I don't know. But I put him blank, I pulled out the gun and shot him in front of everybody. Everybody got up and everybody had a gun. I was like, whoa, whoa, whoa. This guy's on the floor, and everybody's pointing guns everywhere. They grabbed me, and they took me. They kidnapped me. Some people from the bar kidnapped me, some gentlemen from the bars. They kidnapped me. took me to the hills over there in Mexico, to the mountains in Mexico. I knew I was gonna die. You know, what I was thinking was of my friends and my family. I knew I was gonna die once they took me. I knew off the top, I killed one of their friends, they're gonna take me to the mountain and kill me over there. What I was thinking was of my family and my friends that were with me. You know, what was gonna happen to them? Would they ever know about me, or would they ever find me here in Mexico? Later on that night or the next morning, I found out the people that kidnapped me was the drug cartel from Mexico. And the person I shot was one of their enemies. There was a hit out on one of the leaders of the drug cartel that was in that bar. And this guy was hired from another family to come and kill him in that bar. They knew he was there, but they didn't want to make their move because he had made his move. So they were watching. Everybody freaked out because a kid coming from nowhere and shooting a hitman. You know, they were puzzled. So they had to kidnap me to show, to find out who I was, who hired me to do that. When they found out who I was and that I wasn't hired, it was out of disrespect that I did it. This family adopted me into their family with a drug cartel family in Mexico. I was 13 years old, remember? They asked me if I loved guns, and I told them. I told them what I wanted to do. And they promised me that I would be a millionaire by the time I got to 21 years old. I'm 13 years old. They told me, you stay with us, and you become a millionaire at the age 21. At first, I thought they were playing with me. They showed me. I mean, they took me way into the organization with the main people from the drug cartel. They showed me a lot of stuff. They showed me how to use a gun, how to disarm a gun. I used to carry a 50 caliber machine, the one that the Army used. We used to go do blackouts because there were orders in houses in Mexico of people that owed the drug cartel money. You guys seen the news from Mexico, where not even the police officers or the Army in Mexico can stop them because of the high caliber rifles that the drug cartels have. You know, there's a lot of corruption in Mexico. We're losing the battle on drugs in the United States. Well, they done lost it a long time ago in Mexico. You know, because they cannot do nothing political without the drug cartel's orders. That's how bad it is over there. That even they go into the chief of police, they shot him right in his office. You know, when he tried to rebel against the drug cartel. He said it publicly, and they made a statement. They came into his office and shot him in his office at the police station. He's the chief of police in Mexico. Broad daylight, they came and shot him in his office, and nobody got arrested for trying to stop the drug cartels. You know, there's a lot of stuff that goes down with the drug cartel. And that, what I was taught all that when I was 13 years old. Putting people on acid. You know, beheading people. Killing babies. Stuffing them with cocaine and shipping them to New York. As soon as they were born. You know, I didn't do the killings, but I witnessed stuff like that. I didn't believe in God. The drug cartels have their own God. It's an angel of death. At the age of 13, that was the first God I got introduced to, the angel of death, La Santa Muerte in Spanish. That was my God. That's the God I used to pray to at the age of 13 to the age 17. age 17, they sent me and five other guys, older guys, I was the youngest one, to do a drug deal in El Paso. Remember, I've been gone 3 years, almost 4 years with this family, teaching me, showing me. I saw a lot. I saw a warehouse where we would move money with a forklift. Pallets of money wrapped, saran wrap money, stacked. A forklift used to have to move the money. I'm 17, I got a couple of years and I'll be a millionaire. But they told me you gotta drive this mission to El Paso. You're just a driver. We're gonna transfer 30 kilos of heroin across the border to make a deal. But you're the driver. You know, I couldn't say no because they would kill me right there. You know, that's an order. You get orders and you go. There's no yes or no, it's a yes. If you want to die, just say no, you're not going to do it. Right there, you'll die. Right there. There's no optional. It's a contract that you sign with death, because the angel of death is death. And once you start worshiping that angel of death, that's what it means, death. There's no way out of it but to die. They sent me and five other guys, older gentlemen, to do this deal. I was the youngest one. I was 17 at that time. To El Paso to deliver 30 kilos of heroin. This was 1983. We went to go make the deal. On the way over there, the car was already in Texas. I crossed to South America. I'm from the United States, America. They let me through. We meet at the meeting point. We get in the car. It's like 7 o'clock at night. By the time we get to where we're going, it's like 9:30 at night. It's a remote area. It's dark. Excuse me. On the way over there, they got a phone call that it was undercover agents that were waiting for us. The drug deal was going to be to an undercover agent unit. These guys didn't back down. They said, let's go just clean house. Let's do a blackout. A blackout means let's go shoot everybody that's there. In other words, it's if we die, we die, but we're going to go through it. I'm 17, and I said, wait a minute. My mind started thinking. They started pulling out AK-47s, Uzis, machine guns. And I don't got a gun. I'm the driver. They never said nothing about shooting. They never. The guys, when they got that phone call, they're the ones that made that move. We're going through. The main honcho didn't call and say, you know, retreat or go forward. They just called us and tipped us off that there were DEA agents waiting for us. How many? I don't know. When we got there, they told me, do not turn the car off. Wait 2 minutes. Hit the pedal to the metal and take off. I made a U-turn because there was only one entrance and one entrance out. There was no way out, no back street, just one way in. I didn't go all the way in. As soon as I hit the gate, I made a U-turn right there. I didn't go in. So in case they wanted to block us, I was already on the gate. These people got off. Not even a minute. I don't even think they got to where they had to go. And they started shooting. I don't know if you guys been somewhere dark and you throw a firecracker or something, or 100 of them. It just lights up. You know, a little light. You light a cigarette or something in dark and it just lights. Well, can you imagine like 10 guns going off at the same time? Over 100 rounds shot. I mean, it lit up. I dug down and I hit that pedal. But before I did, a friend of ours jumped in the car. While he was jumping in the car to tell me to go, his back just exploded when it hit him as he dove in the car. I hit the pedal to the metal, 17 years old, scared, crying. I didn't know where I was going. I haven't been in El Paso in 4 years. See, I don't have a phone. I don't got the number to Mexico. My whole back is full of blood. I got a dead body in the back seat. The car's getting hit with bullets. I take off at 17. In Texas, there's a Grand Canyon, scenic drive view. It's in the mountains. It's like a hangout place in El Paso. It's the Franklin Mountains. I drove that car to the Franklin Mountains and I stashed it there. When I got off the next morning, it was 6 o'clock, I think. The sun was coming up. I got out and I took the shirt off me. And when I looked back, the guy had a gun in his hand. He was dead. But he had a black duffel bag. That duffel bag had $750,000 cash that belonged to the DEA agent. I opened the trunk to see if there was clothes in the trunk. There was 30 kilos of heroin in the trunk. And nobody following me. No, I'm pretty sure they were looking for me. But I had a gun, $750,000 and 30 kilos and one dead body at the age of 17. I'm strung out, youth. I'm 17 year old, I'm a youth, and I'm strung out on heroin. I took a bite out of one of them kilos, because I was sick, I was getting withdrawals. I took a bite out of that kilo, and I started walking with a duffel bag and the gun in it. I pay for them at a store. I cash a $50 bill from the duffel bag. Luckily, they didn't ask me questions. I made a phone call to a friend of mine in El Paso. He came to pick me up. That night, I buried that money. Before I knew it, I'm on TV. They don't know who I'm at, who I am. They found the car, they found the money, they found the dope, but they didn't find the money. They're looking for the driver. And on the TV, they're saying that the driver had been shot too, because there was blood. Remember, they shot the guy in the back and all his blood moved over. So there's blood in the front. They think I got shot. I didn't get a scratch. I get a hold of the people in Mexico. They already know what happened. And they tell me, just hide. Don't say nothing, just hide. We'll pick you up later. Where am I gonna hide in El Paso? I'm strung out. Heroin addict, but I got on $750,000 cash, stash. I took a couple of hundreds to supply my habit while I was in El Paso. 6 months later, I go to this party. You know, I'm already mixing in the crowd. Nobody knows. They're looking for me in the hospital or in some alley dead with a gunshot wound. The people that were with me, only that one that shot, that got shot, got killed that time. Right there. 3 DEA agents got killed. All the other 4 got arrested. So the other 4 ain't saying nothing about the driver, which is me. They're looking for Mr. John Doe, you know, because they got the prints off the car, but I've never been arrested. I'm a youngster. I'm 17. I'm not even in the system yet. I've never been arrested. I've never got a ticket. I left when I was 13. You know, I was doing robberies before that, but I never got arrested. So they don't know who I am. These guys ain't talking. There's prints in the car, but those prints are coming out negative. Who is this guy? Where is this guy at? The guy that was in the car is dead, so they can't ask him who was driving. They didn't have no leads. So I'm in the clear. I'm partying, having a good time. I got $750,000. I'm 17 years old. I don't got to pull a robbery in my life again. I got to just go to the stash and get $1,000 and just be giving money like Santa Claus. It's their money. The drug cartel members ain't asking for it. They got the dope. here. I was living it up. I go to this one party, and there's a shootout in that party. Gangs, street gangs. And I get shot in the back. Right up on, where my belt goes, my buttock, with a 22. I ended up in the hospital. I woke up and I was in the hospital. There's undercovers, detectives, asking me who shot me. I don't know, they shot me from the back. I was dancing, next thing I know I'm here. You know who shot you and you're a gang member. I don't belong to no gang. I was at a party with some girlfriends and next thing I know I wake up and I'm in the hospital. I don't know what. Oh, so you don't want to talk, and they take my fingerprints. Because I didn't have an ID. Remember, I'm running. I don't have no ID. I've been out of circuit for 4 years. They take my fingerprints and leave. 3 hours later, that curtain opens in the hospital, and they got the cameras on me with guns pulled off, and they shackle me to the bed. And they're UMF this, and where's the money? Putting the gun on my face, and you killed 3 of ours, and now we can kill you right now. I don't know what they're talking about. They want the money. Where's the money? Where's the what money? I don't know. You're the driver. You're the driver of that deal that went bad. So I was all over the news. They got the driver. But they never got the money. At age 17, I got arrested for accomplice to 3 capital murders in Texas. First juvenile trialed as an adult in the state of Texas was me in 1983. I was trialed as an adult, and they sentenced me as a juvenile. All my friends, my associates got the lethal injection. I got life without possibility of parole at the age of 17. To me, it was a joke at that time, because I had never heard that sentence, life without parole. They sentenced me to life without parole at the age of 17. When I got sentenced, I appealed it right away, right then and there I appealed. I thought they were going to give me court the following week. Appeals take time, because they gotta go to the big courts now. It takes years for appeals to come up. But I figured, nah, they're just gonna 5 years and I'll be out. I took, when they sentenced me, I took it as a joke. It didn't hit me. Because my mind was this, at 21, I'm becoming a millionaire. The courts can't stop me now. I'm 2 up there. I'm way ahead of them. Well, they did. They stopped my dream. They stopped my plans. 2 weeks into my sentence, my mom passed away. Remember, I told you my mom was an alcoholic. She died of cirrhosis. So at a young age, she was already diagnosed with cirrhosis. 2 weeks into my prison, into my sentence, she passed away. I get the news, she passed away. I hadn't been sentenced yet, but I didn't have no bail either. I was high risk, because they already knew. The people they had just sentenced were cartel members. I'm the driver. This guy's a cartel member, that's why he hadn't been arrested, because he's been in Mexico training for all this. So they profiled me as a member of a drug cartel, associate, a member of a drug cartel. They weren't going to take a risk of letting me go out to my mom's funeral. I didn't have no bail. I was getting charged with 3 capital murders, accomplice to 3 capital murders. And the way the system is, that's why they changed a lot of laws about shootings, about drive-by shootings. The driver is the worst one. Even though you're not the shooter, if you're the driver, you're the one that's going to get the most time. Because you can veer that car, drive it somewhere else, instead of taking it to do a robbery or to do a murder. I didn't know at that time. That's how come the laws changed a lot about drive-bys. You know, if you do a drive-by and your friend shoots somebody, you get charged with murder too. Even though you're the driver, I didn't shoot. You could have drove somewhere else. That's how the system looks at it. And that's what they told me when I went to court, that I was the worst one of them all. Even though they never found me with a gun, you know, the guys get to their story that they didn't know who I was. That I wasn't the driver. When we went to court, they subpoenaed them. They stood in front of me and they said, "We don't know this guy." But the system saw it. They had enough evidence in that car that I was the driver. But all they wanted was their money. And I wasn't, I don't know what you're talking about. And I don't, in my mind, I'm thinking the cartel members are going to come and bomb me out of this one, send a helicopter, send a bomb. I know what we have, so they're going to make a big opening for me, and I'm just going to walk out of this one. You know, I'm young, 17. I got to go get my million. But when I found out that my mom passed away, yeah, it hit. It stopped me. Reality, it was a reality check. Because right then and there, I didn't know if to blame the drug cartel, to blame her, or to blame God. So I blamed God. Right there, I had a beef with God. I said, "Oh, so you take the most thing I loved in this world, my mom. While I'm doing this, you take her. Well, now that I'm here, I'm going to take everyone that has a Bible in front of me. Whether it's a beating, stabbing, torture, I'm going to do it." That was the promise I made with God. That's how bad I was mad with God. That I turned my back on God, but I'm thankful and I'm grateful for the awesome God that we serve, for His forgiveness. You see, because no matter how mad I was with God, I went after a lot of Christians. I smoked a lot of Bibles. Guys used to come to me in prison and tell me, "Richie, Jesus loves you." And I used to send my friends to hurt them, to take them out of that unit, to really hurt them physically. And I would get their Bible as a trophy, but I would tear pages off the Bible and I would roll cigarettes and weed or cigarettes and I would smoke the Bible. I would never read the Bible. I would smoke it as a trophy. That, yeah, I got one now. You see, I'm showing God what I can do. See, I didn't get arrested, I got rescued. See, I didn't get death, I got life. God's life. God rescued me. Because the path I was going, yeah, I never killed nobody that I know of, that I can honestly say I killed somebody with a gun or with my hands. I hurt a lot of people. You know, I beat up a lot of people. That were Christian brothers and, you know, brothers in prison. Tell me about God. There was somebody in the world praying for me. Whether it was a prisoner, a friend in prison, my mom before she passed away. You know, somebody was praying for me. You see, that's why that John 14:14, ask anything in His name and He will do it. Somebody was praying. In 1998, my appeal came up. I got arrested in 1988, 15 years later. My appeal came up. I went through death row. I was in Fort Knox, which is called the convict unit, lifer unit. I heard a lot of people. I picked up charges, possession charges. I OD twice in prison. I should have died a long time ago. I had COs, which is guards. I had them working for me, bringing heroin to me while I was in prison, because we had kidnapped their families. And that was their, we would pay them to bring me heroin. If not, their families would die. You know, I was involved with big people. But God put a stop to all that. In 1998, my appeal came up. When we went back to court, I thought I had won the case. Me, not God, me. Remember, I had been hurting all these Christians and smoking all these Bibles in prison. My God's an angel of death. All those 15 years, I never changed my thought because I didn't know about God. People would tell me about you. There was people singing in prison. Next door, you know, my next cell, because I was in a one-man cell. Because I was registered as a high-profile, you know, cartel member. They had me in safe, super safe, over there, the dungeons. My neighbor next to me was a Christian, singing praise and worship. I wanted to get to him so bad. I mean, because he would wake up singing praise and worship and talking to me about Jesus and Brother Richie, and I would put toilet paper in my ears. I would spit on my food and tell the guard, I want to eat, give him my plate, you know, stuff that just trying to take him out. They wouldn't give me no cleaning supplies because of the stuff that I knew how to do with chemicals. See, if there was bleach, I would probably put bleach on my food and send it to them. Just to befriend them, just so I could kill them. I mean, those thoughts were the thoughts that were eating me up. But you see, all that money, all that power that that drug cartel had given me, there was still that void. My heart and my life. I was missing Jesus, really. See, but Jesus had his plan. Because when I went to court, and I got him on a technical. The court system, if they draw you as an adult, they have to send you as an adult. See, all my friends got the lethal injection. I got life without possibility of parole. So when we went to court, I got him on that. You see, but God worked all this. Because if he would have left me out in the streets, I don't know, I would have been dead right now. You know, I would have been killed a long time ago. But it's God's testimony, because you know, God was with me through all those times. Through all the bad times, through everything I was taught, God was with me. And I thank God I never had to put none of that into use. Towards people. They took the life back because I got them on the technical. They couldn't sense me again. But remember, I was hurting Christians in prison. I was robbing them, extortion, robbery, assaults. All those are free will cases when you're in prison. And you get accused of some kind of crime, they'll put it on paper. So when you finish your time, you still got this case to take care of. It's an arrest warrant, but they can't arrest you because you're in prison. They can't stack your time. So they had all these charges against me. 15 years, I accumulated like 20-some charges, free will charges. Since I was doing a life sentence, a judge told me, I can give you 10 years on each one of them. I can give you another life sentence on top. But I'll do a deal with you right now. If you sign right now, I'll give you 10 years for all of them. In other words, of all of them, 20-some charges, 10 years. But if you sign right now, without spending taxpayers' money or my time, your time, just sign 10 years and it's a wrap. My mind, I just done 15 years getting high off. 15 years in there, 10 years. I was so happy. gonna go collect my money. I'm gonna, you know, all these thoughts. I mean, all the money. I'm gonna be 21. I'm gonna be a million. I was happy. 10 years going back to prison. Now it's Richie's plan. You guys know about John Gotti? John Gotti is. You guys know he passed away in prison, right? Well, that's where they sent me, where John Gotti was in Colorado. That one, it's a federal prison. It's an underground prison in Colorado. That's where they sent me to do my 10 years. It's 11 stories underground. There's no human contact. There's no visits. There's no telephone. There's no radio, there's no television, there's no next door neighbor, bunkie, whatever. It's no human contact, period. You don't see nobody, you don't even see the guards. All they feed you is peanut butter sandwiches for 10 years. They don't take you to cell porch, to rec time. There's a door that opens and it's a 4x4 with a big old light lamp, those heat lamps, it's a 4x4. That's your rack time. When that opens, you have an hour to be in there. Then it turns on and off. That means to get back in your cell, and that door closes. The next door where you walked in, that door opens and a shower slides in when it's shower time. You jump in the shower for 5 minutes, that water turns off, a buzzer goes off, you jump out, that shower goes back, that door closes. That's your shower. There's a slot, like a V, and when it opens, there's two sandwiches. You close it, you can't open it. Till it opens again, there's two more sandwiches. There's a roll of toilet paper, I think three times a year, they put a toilet paper roll. Three times a year. One roll. There's no toothpaste, toothbrush. I mean, it's either to break you or to kill you. You know, that's the worst punishment. But that's for the worst of the worst. You see, because they figure I have 10 years left. What I did while I was doing those 15 first years, I picked up 28 real charges, you know, that they could give me life for one of those charges. That 10 years, you know, who knows what I could do in those 10 years, sending letters out. They opened that cell, and the only thing that's in there is a restroom, a sink, and a block bed, if you want to call it a bed. It's a big old block. It's a metal block with a mattress like that thick. You know, that's it. And a Bible. Oh, man. That little room was too big for me and the Bible. Either the Bible had to go or I had to go. Because remember, I was mad at God. I was mad. You know, me and God had issues. So I started using, since I didn't have no lighters, no cigarettes, nothing there no more. Nobody was going to bring me nothing. So that's why I started my withdrawal of heroin. Because while I was in prison, I was still doing heroin. I lasted like 3 months withdrawing heroin. You know, that's the worst. I've never had a baby, you know, physically. It was torture. I was tortured. Withdrawing heroin. I don't wish it on my enemy. I don't have no enemies, but I don't wish it, if I was to have enemies, on my worst enemy. Because that's the worst pain. So I would have rather got shot. Just shot. Just take me out of my misery. That's how bad the withdrawal was. 3 months. Throwing the runs, cramps, sweating, chills, nightmares, screaming. But through it all, I know God was there with me. At the time I did it, Now I reflect, yes, God has been with me way before I picked up my habits. And you guys believe in angels? See, I used to use a Bible as a marker, because remember, I have 10 years to do it. I'm at a dead man's zone. Either it's me or death. So I want to prove to death that I know how to make time. But time's not going to do me, I'm going to do the time. So I started using the Bible as a marker to do my workout, because I'm going to come out like the Incredible Hulk. And I'm going to go to the cartel leader, and I'm going to shoot him. I know where all the stuff is, and I'm going to be the number one cartel member of the drug industry. They took 26 years of my life. They took care of me, but now I want more. I want it all. You know, they don't know how to do time. I've done time. In those 5 years, I mean, in those 10 years, 5 years into my stay, I started reading the Bible. But I would read 2 pages and do 20 push-ups, then read half a page and do 10 more push-ups. But it was just to get me pumped up so I wouldn't lose my mind. It was 5 years into my stay. I was asleep and somebody kissed me and woke me up. I mean, I know that door didn't open. Somebody then walked in, kissed me, and ran out in that door closed without me hearing it. I know I wasn't losing my mind. So I woke up and I started looking. There's no closets, there's the restroom, the sink, and my bed. Where somebody was here. Somebody is here. I could feel something, someone. And someone kissed me. But who is it? I'm not going to start screaming or I want to find out who it is. I'm not scared, but it was like a calm, like, I don't know how to explain it. But there started a wind, like a vent, like an air conditioner, like air coming from somewhere. It's sealed, it's a sealed cell. And then a smell, a fragrance. I'm still looking for that smell today. I can't explain the smell because I haven't found it. But if you guys been in the presence of the Lord, you guys are going to know there's a smell, a sweet smell, a perfume. I don't know how to explain it. I knew God was there because when I turned, the Bible came alive. The Bible came alive. I picked up that Bible and I opened it and I just got on my knees and I cried. I cried and I cried for like 2 days. Asking God to forgive me. For everything in my life. Everything I've done.
God is good, brother.
God is awesome. I ask for His forgiveness. You know, to cleanse me. Put him up to a test, you know. At that time, I did, and I told him. If you are God, show me. Show me. show me what to do, because I didn't know. I was trained to be a killer, a hitman, to kill. Remember, God had a different plan. God had his plan. Because God taught me in that cell about what a loving God I had. And that there's only one God, and that's Jesus Christ. You know, he gave his only son for my sins, to pay for my sins. And I was stubborn, you know, because at a young age, you know, he wanted me, he had a plan in my life to praise him and to glorify him, but me being stubborn, you know, I chose the dark side. But I thank God, for God is a light, you know, he didn't have to, but he did. Throughout the mud, throughout my mess, he pulled his hand and pulled me out. And he cleansed me. He cleansed me white as snow. Because all my sins were forgiven. I started reading the Bible. I asked God to be my teacher, to be my mentor. Because I didn't have nobody in that cell. He put me somewhere where I would sit down and pay attention. Because when God wants to tell you something, you see, he sent a lot of people my way, way before I went to that prison, to tell me that Jesus loved me. And I persecuted them. I judged them. And I sentenced them. But I was nobody. You see, there's only one judge. When man sends me to life in prison, that wasn't God's plan. When all that shooting happened, you know, it wasn't God's plan for me to get killed. The ODs I took in prison, it wasn't God's plan for me to die. I should have been dead a long time ago. A lot of us should have been dead a long time. I've never gone homeless. I've never gone hungry. I've never gone thirsty. And I've never gone naked. And he was there in prison. You see, 10 years isolated. It was for me to come out either losing my mind or blind. Because after 10 years without seeing the sun, you come out and you see that sun that rays will blind you. I would have lost my mind. I thank God I didn't catch some kind of disease using all those dirty needles in prison. They almost cut off my arms, though. Both of them at the same time. Where my arms, 85% of my body got infected. Using dirty needles. There was abscess growing in my body. And they had to shut them off. But they told me they were going to cut off my arms. Because in prison, they don't do surgeries. Either they just chop it off or they let gangrene take care of them. And that didn't stop me. You see? But it's God's plan. All this is God's plan. I got out in 2009. Remember, I got arrested in 1983 to 2009. The day they opened that cell for me to get out, I didn't want to get out. Because my best friend was with me. God was with me. I was in the Bible so much that I didn't want to be in prison. Remember, I had a plan to be the number one cartel member. You see, all those plans went out the window. Because it wasn't God's plan. That was Richard's plan. But when God has a plan in your life, He ain't going to stop. When that blessing comes, not even the devil can stop it. Because it comes from God. And God's the ruler of all. He's the King of Kings. It was His plan that took those thoughts, that desire out of me. And I told him, I asked Him for three prayers. Because I came across that John 14:14. Ask anything in my name and I will do it. And I prayed, honestly, prayed with my heart, and I said, okay, I'll put you to the test. One day, to be free, a free man. Number two, to have a son with my name. In case something happens to me, he can finish my race. And number three, to have a godly wife in my life. You see, God would answer prayers in His time. He could have given them to me like that. But then I would forget who God was. You see, we ask a lot to God in prayer. He'll do it. It's our God. My God's not a lying God. My God's an awesome and truthful God. He's a merciful God. As long as somebody's praying, He will answer that prayer because every word that goes out of their mouth won't come back for it. You know, that's what my Bible has taught me. That's what my teacher has taught me, which is my God. Because if you die before that answer, prayer is done, then He lied. He can't kill you. You cannot die and go before the Father without your prayers being answered. Because then it contradicts Him of a liar. So if you're praying, it will come through. Because we serve an awesome God, a truthful God. 2009, December 24th, I was released from prison. From Colorado, PAC 1, federal prison. It's an underground prison. December 24th, I was released, 2011, my son was born. His name is Ricardo Sepulveda, Jr. October 22nd, 2011, I got married to a godly wife. I met her at church. You know, in 3 years, in less than 3 years, I got out a free man. I'm not on parole, probation, nothing. I don't know the county, the state method. A free man. My son was born with my name. I got married to a godly wife. She was already in the church when I met her. We've been married a year and 2-3 months. But we did it right before God and before our congregation, Seventh-day Adventists. See, I'll never stop learning. And I'll never stop running this race. You see, because what God started, He will finish. He started something in me. Before I was born, just that I had to go through this to let others know that Christ is alive. He's a true God, and He answers prayers. It's not what I've been through. what I've gone through is to let you know that God cares for every one of us. Because we're all walking testimonies. We all have something that God has gotten us through or is going to get us through. He's always with us. He was always with me. I just never knew. Now what we do, we have a ministry called God's Got My Back Ministry. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. Because God's got my back. See, a lot of people were asking me about the cartel members. You can't get out of that. You know, they're coming after you. And they know I'm out. They know who I serve too. Because I'm not ashamed of my God. Because my God said, if you're ashamed of me, deny me in the earth. I will deny you in front of my Father. And that's what promised us. I cannot deny my God. Because I don't care how much money I've seen in life. I'm richer now in heaven. Because that's where all my blessings are at. That's where all my riches are in heaven. Because I know where I'm going to be if I was to die. I know who I'm going to go serve and see. You know. The angel of death gave me death. But greater is he that went and took the keys out of death and gave me life. And that's Jesus Christ. You see, and now I serve him and him alone. I don't do nothing without starting my day on my knees. Thanking God for another day and to use me in his will, not to do what I want to do, but his plan in my life. We have a ministry, we go to Skid Row, feed homeless people. You know, I talk to a lot of gang members, a lot of drug addicts, a lot of youth. You know, we go all over Southern California. You know, wherever we get invited, we go, because it's God's plan. It's not my plan. See, I was locked up too long to stay in one service, one church. You see, we're Seventh-day Adventists, and a lot of people know. Everywhere we go, they know. But it's not just about it, man. Like I say, it's not about religion or tradition. It's about telling you guys that Jesus Christ is real, and he loves us all. He loved me so much that he set me free. I'm free indeed in Jesus Christ. You see, I still get high every day with him because he's the utmost high. You see, and it's free. I don't have to pay for my high because he paid for it with his life for me, for you. You know, and it's free. I can call him any time of the hour, anywhere. I'm never alone. With money or no money. However I'm dressed, I can call him. Because he don't judge me. So who am I to judge others? You know, that's why we cross boundaries. To let people know. We meet him at the street corners, in alleys. Whatever, in restaurants, church, houses, meetings, schools. And just let them know Jesus loves you. Because maybe they've never heard of Jesus. Maybe they've had a house like I had a house, where there was no God involved in my house. We're putting up a challenge with the youth. We have a premium business going right now. We're doing t-shirts. And we're trying to print t-shirts with favorite scriptures of congregations that invite us. We'll bring the printers and the pressers and t-shirts. And you guys bring your favorite scriptures. We'll type it into the computers and send out a print. And you guys can print your own t-shirts, scriptures, and wear them. I'm not ashamed to let people know that who I serve. You know, because I remember times when I used to be in the drug dealers' houses, weighing ounces and kilos of drugs. Back then, I didn't know who God was. But now that I know who God is and what he did for me, I'm telling the world who I serve. Whether they accept it or not, they're not going to be with me in Judgment Day. It's between me and God. And if I deny him now, he'll deny me in front of my Father. That's the way I look at it. A lot of us are afraid to say we belong to the family of God, especially youth in schools. That peer pressure. Look at all the shootings that are going on in schools. Come on, in schools. Where's God in all this? Where? It starts at home. Having fellowship at home before you go out with your father, your kids, your parents. Talk about God. Read them with scripture before they go out the door. Let them know who comes first in their life, God. Invite their friends over. See who their friends are and see what their beliefs are. I mean, there's a lot of killing going around in schools right now. And that's the devil trying to flip the script on all of us. Trying to discourage us from coming to church. You know, we're more focused on guns and violence. And you know what? Thank God. Thank God. Praise God. I don't lean on my own understanding. I lean on God. And that's what we're trying to do. Reach the youth. You know, different levels, different devils. You know? We go through a lot of stuff. You know, but that's God's will. You know, preparing us to go to another level. But remember, each level that God takes you to, there's different devils. The same devil that messed with you when you were young is not going to mess with you now that you know more. There's more stuff coming, bigger. Stay rooted, stay foundated, and stay plugged in. Do for others. You know, God cared so much that he gave, he gave. He was a server, he served. That's what we should do, serve. Serve others. And just let the blessing pour. Let the blessing pour. It will pour. My name is Ricardo Sepulveda. If you know me and forget me, you don't lose nothing. But if you know Jesus Christ and forget him, you will lose everything. And that's my testimony, and thank you for letting me come down and share my testimony with you guys. Amen. Amen.
I would just like to add that, you know, just that even where we're at right now, things are not easy. Not easy for everybody here. Life is only getting tougher out there, so you gotta really start holding on to Jesus a lot more. Just hold on, you know, just hold on and don't let go. You know, because it's not easy. It's still, for us, it's still not easy. Every day is a trial, every week's a trial. You know, when we're sitting in front of each other one time, and the boss of these illegal drug companies from Mexico called him up, he was sitting, they had his daughter. He said, you come back, we'll kill her. He had to decide, hey, kill her. I'm in church, I'm with Jesus, this is where I choose to be. He had to choose between his daughter. And it's still a challenge. He's, right now his daughter's missing, you know, so we don't know what's happening, but we know that a lot of people are praying for her. And pray for each other, because sometimes the church is a very lonely place too. And we need each other, you know. We don't know what each other is going through. And we need to be embracing each other and loving each other, because it's getting tough out there, you know. Many are losing their homes, their lives, you know, their children, disease, cancer. You know, we need to reach out to each other and love each other even more. As the times get tougher, hold on to each other more and look for Jesus more. You know, and that's why we try to go out there and try to get hope. You know, Jesus is our hope. And that's what we go out there and tell. Jesus loves you.